So the last talk of the day, Sirag Pimchik will tell us about Poisson Litchi Duval and Interdoja.
Thank you. So first of all, I wish to thank organizers. I'm happy to be here in the country and to participate and to give a talk at this meeting. Thank you. Then about the subject, there were two predictions yesterday and today. One was your king and the king. Because they predicted that I would speak about the deformation on the gravity side. This was a correct prediction. But actually, there are many students here. I think it would be a good idea not to get inside many technical stories, but rather to speak generally about several things which are here in the title already mentioned. So probably not many people know what it means, Poisson asymmetry. So I will say something, but T-duality is better, I think, that people know. But Poisson T-duality is quite specific T-duality. And integrability is also known stuff, but not that known in the connection with Poisson asymmetry and T-duality. So this work which I did put all the things, put these things together. And the idea is that you know very well that dynamical system in physics, where the classical quantum may enjoy symmetries. And symmetries are often very useful because they give the system a nice structure and which may render them easier to treat. And so if you see a symmetric system, for example, this principle, heuristic principle, showed up in the case of T-duality. For example, I shall tell you what is T-duality, but you have some sigma models, and if it is symmetric, it can be T-dualized. Then another example is that if you have sigma model, still you should know what it is, but I will remind you, then if it is a symmetric, it has a bigger chance to be integral. Now, there exists a way to deform the symmetry to the Poisson-Lee symmetry. The topic was quite hot in the 80s when I was young. Unfortunately, I learned it just by curiosity, because there were several Russians who passed by Prague University, I should talk about that. And later, it turned out that this Poisson-Lee story could be used in string theory. So this, I refer to the paper which was written in 90s about Poisson-Lee T-duality, which at that time was accepted as some interesting theoretical structure. But now, 20 years later, this Poisson-Lee deformation idea is used as a guiding principle to deform the ADS-CFT correspondence. So the idea is that you start on the gravity side and you deform a string motion. You know the ADS surface and S5 has a lot of symmetry. And the idea is that you deform this symmetry to Poisson symmetry. Since there are many Poisson structures, so there are many possible deformations on this side, and you expect then on conformal field theory side, you will obtain a Super-Young-Mills theory living on non-commutative manifold. That's what you expect. So this is the program. So, already Kostas mentioned today that on the ADS side there was some deformation known already in 2005. So there is work by Yoshida and his students that this deformation is also a Poisson-Lee type, so very simple form. But there exists a more complicated Poisson-Lee deformation last 3 years there were a lot of activity, about 100 papers about that. There was also another deformation found of ADS. The first one deformation, which I talked about, is called ETA. And then Svetsos found the lambda deformations. And it turns out rather remarkably that the lambda deformation of Svetsos is Poisson T dual. In this case, the Poisson V duality is becoming the part of true string theory, and not just a mathematical curiosity. So, I should say maybe now more about all this stuff. So, I start with sigma order. So, this is a reminder. So, you have a manifold which is called the target space. And on this manifold, you have some geometrical structure. So first of all, I put coordinates, because we are physicists, so I put some coordinates. There is a way to get. There are some coordinates on the manifold. And then there is a covariant tensor with two indices, which gives some geometrical structure. And then you can associate to these quantities the action and the field in this action. There are as many fields as there are coordinates. They depend on the Rothschild, and the action is not what it is. It's this object. Well, let me stress that those objects are just chiral derivatives. So, whenever you have a manifold T and some geometrical structure, this tensor in general is not symmetric, neither anti-symmetric. It's just a generic tensor. You may study the classical string motion of that, but you know that there may be some anomaly, that there is a conformal symmetry condition which have to be fulfilled to go to the full quantum theory. But let me stick for the moment on the classical story, because already on the classical level you may observe a lot of structure in such a theories which are called the sigma model. There's one sigma model which is of particular interest. It lives on group manifold, compact group manifold, which for me will be just asymmetric. You will not lose anything substantial if you stick on this example, which I have already talked about. And you know that the elements of MUN, there are some unitary matrices with unit determinants, which I called, you know, as G. So the string worksheet moving in some group is characterized by matrix is unit determinant, which depends on something. And I should write the action, so I write it in a way which doesn't look like this. So why? This is the action. Here's a trace. That's what it is, so this field G is this one. And why you don't see that is this, why? Because this matrix element, JIK, of these fields are overdetermined system of coordinates on the group manifold. But in this overdetermined system, this action looks more simply. But if you go to some coordinates in the group manifold, which people like to do, for example, they take a group S of 3 and they take an Euler parametrization, then they will recover such object, and it turns out that in this case this tensor is symmetric, and it's a metric on the group manifold, and which one the metric? The one which is given by Killing, Cut, and Form. So you know that if you take a group manifold G, every group manifold has one point which is more important than other, king point, which is unit point. And so if you take a tangent space at this unit point, you have a natural metric given by Killing, Cut, and Form from the Lie algebra of this group. And this metric can be transported to every point in the group by left or right group shift, doesn't matter, because this metric is pi invariant. And you obtain the metric which appears here. But believe me, it's much more convenient to study this model invariantly without introducing any coordinates. Now, what is this? Very simple. So if you take two elements of Lie algebra, is just a trace. It's one thing, and if you ask me what kind of matrices are elements of Lie algebra in the context of SUN, those are anti-Hermitian matrices. So the matrix that is anti-Hermitian. Anti-Hermitian. Which means that if you take the Hermitian conjugate, you obtain minus x. And it turns out that this object, which is here, is just anti-unitary matrix. So everything is consistent. And this is a sigma model. Actually, people do not study it in bosonic string theory because this model developed conformal anomaly. But they do study it in string theory, because, you know, conformal anomaly, which is cured by Westermann-Witten term. However, if you go to supergroup case, then you don't need in some situation the Westermann term, because the story is already conformal invariant, which may not be known. But this is very agreeable stuff for ADS CFT, because you are not adding Westermann-Witten term, and still you have conformal invariant. So this model has a lot of symmetries. For example, if you take any constant matrix and multiply the field from the left, you obtain a new solution. So if G sigma tau is a solution of the field equation which comes from this Lagrangian, then if you multiply by a constant element of SUN, this solution, you will get another solution. And the same is true if you multiply it from the other side. Okay. So this symmetry is responsible for the integrability of this model, as found by Cherenkov, by Zakharov, Mikhailov in the 70s. And then, 10 years later, Cherednik asked the question, can this model be deformed? In the way compatible with integrability. And this question turned out to be hard. After 30 years, it was not solved in mathematics. And so my motivation was not ADS CFT, because it's strange, but when I was working on Poisson-Lie T-duality in the middle of 90s, I was a believer that in string theory it could be useful. Then 10 years later, I lost my belief, and I have been looking at some other stuff. So I was trying to answer this question, which was asked by Cherednik. And the idea was that, for some reason which I will explain, that maybe the Poisson-Lie deformation of this stuff could be integrable, and this would solve the Cherenkov problem. So the answer to these questions is affirmative, it is the case. then I write to the counselor, what is this? I don't try to show you. Look at this equation. If you set alpha to zero, you recover the principal higher model. If alpha is not zero, this model is possibly deformation. Whatever it means, I will explain, but it is this. So the question whether this object can be possibly deformed, the answer is yes. And it turns out that the expression of this deformation is very nice and compact, which is in the Poisson-Lee world exceptional. You know, Poisson-Lee world is often messy from the technical point of view. And here you are able to understand every letter in this expression but R. R, there is some object which I do not explain what it is. And it turns out that R is some operator on the Lie algebra. So if I note the algebra of G is by small letters, R is the operator which goes from S to N. And this operator turns out is well known in the literature since 50 years. It's a Young-Baxter. So what is the Young-Baxter operator in this context? So you take a matrix, and every matrix has a structure like this. It's a diagonal part. This upper triangle part. And there is a lower triangle part. So this is anti-unitary matrix. So this is some stuff here. You put it U plus, this stuff here is U minus, and this stuff is diagonal. So you apply this operator, and by definition, it gives this. Multiply by I plus, by minus I multiply minus, and I set 0 here. And such operator is called the Young-Baxter operator. And it turns out that this object, which is called Rx, is also anti-unitary matrix, so this is a well-defined operator. And it fulfills some relation which in the literature appears written differently, but I believe that this way of writing it is particularly illuminating. And this is a famous Young-Baxter equation. So this is a way of writing famous Young-Baxter equation. Actually, because there is one more term on the right hand side, this one. This is called the modified Young-Baxter equation. Without this term, Young-Baxter equation. In this term, this is a modified equation.
Shouldn't we call this classical?
This is a classical R matrix. This is not your R matrix. This is a classical. You can, this business which I'm going to expose with Poisson-Lee, you can quantize it. And this structure, when it gets quantized, gives you the quantum. Why I can quantize it? Because all manifolds which I'm going to describe you will carry the Poisson bracket. And so if you quantize this Poisson bracket, this gives you the quantum R matrix, which I can show you after the program works.
Modified
top. This modified term, if it's not here, then in the SUM case, there is no R matrix which would exist, and there is no deformation. modified term is important. This modified term may either be here or not, or it may appear with minus sign. It turns out that if you do the job with compact groups, here the sign is plus. If you do the job with maximally non-compact group, the sign is minus. And they have very accurate possibilities. But I'm doing the job with compact group. But in the case of Eddie's CFA, there is also non-compact here, and this minus may be relevant.
The x and y matrices are elements of the algebra of a student.
Okay.
And is this, when you write down this equation, r times this thing is equal to that, does that not completely fit r? Meaning there is some.
They do not completely fix r. They fix it up to Klingfeld twist of constants. So this r can be twisted. But Klingfeld twist is relatively, not complicated deformation. So this is almost complicated. Actually, what did those Japanese, that they took this model, and they put it just the Klingfeld twist, and they obtained Lunin-Maldacena. Well, Yoshida, it's easy to remember, but there are many others. Matsumoto is also
there. The second equation, should be thought of as a constraint on R?
No, this
follows from the first one?
This, there are two ways to look at this equation. Either it's identity, which is fulfilled by this operator.
Is it true for all values of R which will satisfy the first equation?
No. R, for me, is just this operator. Very concrete one.
Okay.
And this operator verifies this identity.
Okay.
In the context of our talk, it's enough. Of course, there is a theory, what is a general solution of Lambert's equation, big theory, but I need just this solution. Because I'm giving an example, many things which I'm going to say, they are sufficiently complicated to give a flavor of what I'm doing, but they are not totally general because this would take a lot of time to express.
Maybe one more question. Is deformation, if I go down to one dimension, so it is a top, that is solvable? What is the spectrum?
I don't know what is the property of integrability, because the dimension of space-time is important. The problem is that the Lux sphere,
But I can look at the top.
You can, but what is important that the Lux sphere features differential operator. So typically, Lux sphere one plus one dimension is d sigma minus some matrix. And in 0 plus 1 dimension, there is not that term. So this changes.
No, I agree. Just the curiosity is.
I don't know what happens. But it can be written this.
Yes, it exists as a deformation.
It exists as a deformation. I don't know what type of problem. Now, why is this important? Because you can define a bracket on the SUN, which is a Lie bracket. It turns out that this is normally bracket of SUN, which is at the commutator of matrices. And this is a new bracket. So in the Lie algebra SUN, remarkably, you have two different brackets. The first one is SUN, the second one is this strange bracket. Okay, so you have two Lie algebra structure. And this is, if you try to check Jacobi identity for this bracket, you see that you need just this Young-Baxter equation. So this is the reason for this Young-Baxter equation. And this pair of bracket defines the bi-algebra. In other words, possible structure. So if you choose some orthonormal basis, orthonormal basis on S to N. Dietitrans then let us make the definition of structure constant. I write all indices upstairs because this is a Kronecker delta. And then the structure constant of other bracket I will call F tilde. This is some preliminary stuff. Okay. Let me see what I prepared. Okay. So, this is the result. You know, if you get to sleep right now, you will. So this is a result. In the string, if you want to use this in ADS CFT correspondent, you must have two generalizations. One is naturally you have to grow from group to supergroup. And other one is that you have to consider the homogeneous spaces you introduce here at the level between those two currents, you introduce some projectors. But anyway, if you do that, you obtain the deformed ADS action, which you know that normally the sigma model, which corresponds to the dynamics of strings on ADS side, was constructed by Metzai and Zetlin. And if you put inside this Young-Baxter operator, and it was then the and it's a generalized this Metzayev Zetlin action to this Young-Baxter stuff. So now let me explain you this a digression. I don't know how far I will go, but let me explain you what is Poisson-Lee symmetry in general. So you know that what is a symplectic manifold, presumably? So you have manifold M, you have antisymmetric tensor, which admits an inverse. Okay, not every antisymmetric tensor has inverse. This inverse tensor is contravariant. And its role is that if you have two functions living on the manifold, you can define the Poisson bracket. Okay. Right, this way. And this is written this way. I hope that you can read it. Now, if you take a symplectic manifold and you define one function on it, smooth function, which is called Hamiltonian, you obtain the so-called dynamical system. Now, whatever classical dynamical system which you meet, whatever the way it's defined, it boils down to this structure. Manifold, which is called phase space, symplectic form, Poisson bracket, and Hamiltonian. But if you ask moreover the symmetry, so you need some bunch of vector fields. Actually, I have chosen the basis TA on this unit. So for every TA, I need a vector field VTA, which I will know as TA. And sometimes I will know it. I will put also explicitly the new index. Or sometimes I may also write this. Okay. All the time it's the same symbol. The same manifold. And now, what it means that if you have a G ordinary, not possibly ordinary G symmetric dynamical system, G symmetric system, M omega H, mean that you play game with Lie derivatives. So if you take Lie derivative VR of Poisson bracket, you obtain zero. If you take the Lie derivative of any of the fields, and eventually I put it here, the derivative of H is zero. So if you have such conditions, so you have such vector field, you know what it means, this condition for example, it means that the group G acts infinitesimally on the manifold. This condition is the Hamiltonian invariant and this is Poisson bracket. Now, Poisson-Lie symmetric system is different stuff. So the first thing does not change. The second Poisson-Lie symmetric system has the same manifold, one parameter family of symplectic forms, and the same Hamiltonian. And this one found the family of symplectic forms, so form is supposed to verify the following condition. And the third one remains the same. So this is all. Of course, there is some rationale behind such a structure, but as far as the definition is concerned, it's written here. That's all what is needed. So in this particular case, this dual Lie algebra structure appears. In this particular case. And this epsilon, the role is epsilon, if epsilon goes to zero, you recover the original. In this sense, this object is called Poisson-Lie deformation of this dynamical system. And now it turns out that you can, if I give you the R operator, then you can calculate this form. If you can show that it exists, you can calculate it, the formula is typically ugly. But in principle, you can calculate this is stuff which was calculated by 9 people by the group around Alexei. Now, you ask
for this to work in the symplectic manifold?
Huh?
So, for this all to be there, the symmetry will be the symplectic.
No, it's always symplectic. It's always. Now, you would say that if this deformation theory is well understood, and there are so many symmetric dynamical systems around, why don't we take them and do not deform one after another to see what it gives? And it turns out that if you work out the theory of this deformation, you typically find several disagreeable things. And one agreeable, so two disagreeable, one agreeable. First disagreeable thing is astonishing. If you take whatever function on your manifold, M, which does not change, the deformation does not change, right? And you calculate this Poisson bracket with Hamiltonian, which is epsilon dependent, because the Poisson bracket depends on epsilon. you find this thing. It's epsilon independent. This is not a theorem, but in many cases it happens. It means that dynamics of this system, in spite of the fact that you change the Poisson graphic, and if you change the Poisson graphic bracket, it means that you change the, naively we would say that you change the field equation, because field equation is just a Hamiltonian equation. But it turns out that this does not change. This is very specific. And then people say, what is it good for if all the deformed systems have the same dynamics? Actually, they have the same first order dynamics. And in string theory, the second order dynamics is important. You know, it's T-duality story. T-duality is that you have two very different geometrical backgrounds on which you formulate the sigma model, which are erased, unfortunately. It's like this stuff, this Lagrangian. And the T-duality story is just a statement that you may have totally different manifolds with different new end and different coordinates. But if you look at the first order dynamics, they are equivalent. So this T-duality is a statement. The two sigma models living on the different manifolds, if you study the symplectic structure of them, then you obtain the equivalent story. This looks amazing, but this is a definition of T-duality. If you take two sigma models, everybody probably knows how to calculate the conjugated variable and from every of these actions. You find the phase space description of the sigma model, you evaluate Hamiltonian, you find the symplectic form, and it turns out that structure calculated from T-dual sigma model gives identical dynamic system. This is by definition T-dual. So in string theory, the second order Lagrangian has sense. It's not just first order dynamics which come. And this is important piece of story. It means that those deformation remains interesting in spite of the fact of this strange property. But this property is also extremely positive. Why? Because maybe you know what is integrability in the Lux sense. Actually, I don't know integrability in any other sense. It means that you can define as R0 what is integrability with a Lux pair, but if you want to construct the integrable model, it goes through the Lux stuff. So Lux integrability is fairly general stuff, which completely covers also ADS CFT. Integrability, which appears on the gravity side, is Lux integrability. So what is Lux integrability for general dynamical system? So you have a manifold, you have a Poisson bracket, and then you have two more matrices. One is called Lux matrix, another is called auxiliary matrix. And there's matrix of some mysterious size, which may be n to n, n squared, whatever. And so there are matrix of functions on the phase space. So if you have coordinates x on the phase space, you have matrices of, which depends on these coordinates. And these matrices fulfill the following relation. L, H. So this is a matrix, this is not a matrix, it's just a function. So if I write Poisson bracket of L is H, I mean I take a Poisson bracket of every element of this matrix. And this object is called, is equal to, and this is just the commutator of the matrices. There are no Poisson. So whenever you are able for your dynamical system to find such matrices, then it turns out that you can construct many integral of motion, typically in finite dimension system, as many as there is the dimension, so you can render it completely. In the infinite dimensional case, you also are this Lux bay was constructed for the principal chiral model by Zakharov Mikhailov and for the deformation of principal chiral model. It was done by myself. So I constructed the Lux bay for deformation. But this was not easy, difficult, because I knew that it existed. And why I knew that it exists, I explain it, because I knew that this is true. If this is true, I can put in epsilon. Okay. I have Lux cheaply. So I solved the Cheretnik problem. Right? Because I knew that what is Poisson symmetry. And so I Poisson deformed principal chiral model. And I obtained this model, which is here. This model has a very nice feature that it's not complicated. So I think that this also helps if you want that people follow you. If you write the formula, which you would not like to meet in the midnight in the dark forest, so this would not work, you know, but this formula is simple, it helps. And now what is, I told you that there is also one disadvantage or drawback, this is that generally, the Poisson-Lee deformed systems are tough to describe. And this one is nice. It turns out. So now I still have some 17 minutes. So did I say what is integrability? More or less, yes. There is no big deal, you know, to show that this is integrable, because due to this property, I take this Lux pair of Zakharov-Mikhailov and I have integrability automatically. Now you know what is harmonics, you know what is a Poisson-Lee symmetry, this may help in general. This type. And T-duality, so yes. So T-duality, I also explain what it is. So this model has a T-dual. The T-dual is not that nice. I'm not saying that it's ugly.
So if you say integrability, but isn't it stronger? Is it a bit of action zero?
This one not. This one not. This one has interesting thing, very interesting feature that if you renormalize this model, it remains, keeps the same form, but this parameter alpha flows. It changes epsilon, because tangent alpha is epsilon. So with the renormalization flow changes this epsilon.
But then how can it be string theory?
Because if you write it, as I told you, I erased this Delbruck, Magro, etc. If you do those two modifications which I did, that you have to put a projector which projects on the homogeneous space. And you consider the supergroup which appears in ADSC. And if you put this, it turns out that beta function is zero. So it is conformal. So it's conformal whatever is alpha. Yes.
Earlier you mentioned that if you have symmetric sigma models, most probably they will be integrable.
It's not integrable, but before I arrived at this Poisson-Lee story, people were setting their right, have written, they were looking for Lux pairs. So they have written the overdetermined systems of nonlinear equation for matrix L. And this was very overdetermined. So it was not, they didn't find any other solution unless they supposed that this L is highly symmetric. So I'm not saying that symmetry itself guarantees integrability. But if practically, if people were looking for integrable models, if there was no symmetry, those equations were hopeless. And now, by this observation that in Poisson Lee stuff, you have this miraculous relation, you have for granted that this system of spherical equation, there's a solution, and this solution is given just by this. And the only identity which you need to check that this solution is Young-Baxter. So maybe you would like to see what is this symplectic form. What is the dynamical system in the first order formalism which underlies at the same time the principal chiral model and its Young-Baxter deformation. So what is the manifold N? What is the symplectic structure omega? And what is Hamiltonian? No, this is just the Poisson dual, so it's more complicated stuff. Actually, this is lambda model, which mentioned Costas. When Swetsos calculated, found its lambda model, he didn't know that it's Poisson ET dual Young-Baxter, so this was quite nice. To give him justice, it was him who suspected that this lambda model is possible. And then I gave it. So, look. There is a, what is the phase space? The phase space is given by two functions of periodic parameter sigma, and those functions live in the Lie algebra SUN. So they are anti-Hermitian matrices which depend on sigma. The symplectic structure, this is not epsilon, this is alpha, so forgive me. But there is some parameter. And the Hamiltonian doesn't depend on this parameter. And if you calculate now the field equation, which are this, or this is a field equation, you find the story which does not depend on alpha, which is consistent with this statement. What it means? It means that if you want to solve the deformed ABS CFT, you have to solve the same equation as non-deformed. Anyway, the string background is different. But the equation are the same. This looks astonishing, but it's true. So, in the case where there is no projector and no supergroup, this equation, and this is exactly the equation considered by Zakharov, Mikhailov, in the case of principal chiral model, this is not surprising, you know, because I am deforming the principal chiral model. Those are equations of principal chiral model. This was the discovery of Zakharov, Mikhailov, the principal chiral model, which action I wrote at the beginning. And the first order formalism has this nice structure. This is even the Lux pair written here, which depends on the spectral parameters. It doesn't matter what it is, because in the deformed case is the same story. There is another nice thing, that this is called the symplectic current algebra of the dream phantom, just the observation, which is not important in the context of this talk, but is important in the context of modern thinking. So there is a mistake, there should be I here. And now you would like to go from first order to second order. This is a tricky operation, as you see, because in the first order you have two coordinate functions J and K, and if you want to go to the second order, you trade these coordinates for coordinates group value G, and J you let the same, And if I told you that the resulting model is nice and easy, so this is the resulting model, the fact which is responsible for this nicety or beauty of them is this relation. So this is a change of variable from JK to GJ, and the old story, a non-trivial part of work which was necessary to do to obtain the deformation, was to find this relation. So I succeeded to find it, and then everything was almost automatic. Now look, if in this new variable J and G, the Poisson brackets are nothing but the cotangent bundle bracket of the loop. And what this is interesting, because what I'm saying that this also must be correspond to the cotangent bundle of the loop. Yes, and this is true for every alpha. How it's possible? Is that the symplectic form on the cotangent bundle is a scalar. So I think that this is for the Young-Baxter model, and there are some other results which I can show you. So there is a way how to construct the Poisson VT. So you have to trade the coordinates k and j on the k space for coordinate p, which is Hermitian matrix, and for g valued high. And if you work out the symplectic form and Hamiltonian, you find the Poisson dual. This formula looks ugly, but what is nice about it, that this is just the lambda model, which was discovered by Svetsos for different reasons. So those models are possibly P-dual, one to another. About the meaning in string theory, this model, the Poisson T-dual, is better property because people know the Dirac. So this is full-fledged to string solution. In the original model, they have problem to find the Dirac. Because this is important, this is a classical story. Classical story may help, and it helps a lot, but at some point you get to the quantum story, and the Dirac was the quantum, and this classical analysis says nothing to do with the further analysis has to be done. And in this dual case, the Dirac was found, so this is the reason why this is a hot it's active topic. In the original case, it turns out that there will be some strange vector-like Dirac story. This is much studied by Zeppelin, but also the people who studied the generalized complex geometry. Independently, they suspected that there should be something like vector-like Dirac, and this vector-like Dirac appears in this sample. Now, this is a sparsely symmetry, this I explained. There is a Young-Baxter sigma model. You know, at the very beginning I told you that if you have Poisson principal higher model, it has two symmetries from the left, and you can multiply it from the right. And if you do Young-Baxter deformation, this symmetry becomes Poisson, and this symmetry remains ordinary. But you can deform both symmetry to the Poisson case. And this gives a model which also has some illusion. So it's called the Bayer-Baxter. The Lex pair, it turns out that it's still the same, because even if you have two parameter deformation, this there is some Poisson T-dual which is interesting because for some reason this model was found by Zeitlin in the 90s with having no idea that this related to some Poisson history or T-duality, or just that, yeah. And now is some general story of construction of general Poisson-Lee symmetric models, because what I did now, it was from the group SUN, and for one particular Poisson-Lee structure given by Young Baxter operator, which is written. Now the story can be done for whatever group, compact simple group, for whatever Young-Baxter operation, and even for Poisson-Lee structure which are not based on Young-Baxter operation. Because the Poisson-Lee structure which are based on the Young-Baxter operator are called cohomologically trivial. And there are many other Poisson-Lee structures which are not cohomologically trivial. But you can construct the Poisson-Lee symmetric systems. About integrability, I don't know. And since I have 4 minutes, I will not go through this general construction, and I prefer to speak.
Any questions?
So the strings on these fibers one has PSU 2.4.
Yes, the symmetry is SU224. But now it becomes Poisson-Lee symmetry. And on SU224, there are many Young-Baxter operators. So people write papers, they classify them. Yoshida, for example, every Young-Baxter operator, he constructs a supergravity background construct.
For example, the TST transform theory, and the different symmetry.
But this is ordinary symmetry. But I'm telling you that Lunin Bardet-Marlatsan-Beckmann has SU224 symmetry, which is Poisson-Lee. And only part of the symmetry is the ordinary symmetry which you speak about. This is a Poisson-Lee. It is much in the spirit of Costas, you know, that you break something and you say, I lost some symmetry. No, the symmetry remains there, but it's deformed. But it was Yoshida who worked out Lunin Bardet-Marlatsan. He turned out, he found, in the context of SU24, he found the R operator, which gives exactly Yoshida Bardet-Marlatsan.
And for example, some people think the gauge theory side, some quantum is amazing.
For sure. You know, this is what Costas is doing. There is, you know that gauge theory on the background was a hot topic some 15 years ago. And this is exactly what is going on. There should be on the CFT side, there should be non-Tabelian theory, supersymmetry on non-commutative space. For sure. And this, the structure of the non-commutative space is given just by this power. So if Costa says that there are some problem to find our matrices, I would say that quantizing this R matrix is accessible.
So from class collection, you can define model matrix, eigenvalue that defines spectrum.
Yes.
So for example, AGS5S5, the positive momentum, that is not eigenvalue.
This is the same class.
Same.
This is, for me, this was a big surprise that you take two models. Look now. Look at this model, which is Young-Baxter. Whatever is alpha, even alpha zero, it gives principal higher model, the structure of field equation is the same. Written here. not just sigma modelization. And you arguably know this young Baxter sigma model does lose the symmetry. No, this does not have the symmetry. Of course, this. The metric is deformed. The B field is deformed. In the principle family model, you don't have B field. In the young Baxter theory, you have B field. In spite of all of this, the equation of motion, the first order, it doesn't mean it's still a fact. You have to find a way how to get from second order to first order, which is given by this equation.
Any other questions?
So this equation is the hard stuff, so you have to find the protocol. In many Poisson asymmetric systems, this is inaccessible. The fact that it's accessible from principal chiral model is enormous luck. It's a great luck, you know, that it's so simple. Because at this symplectic structure, you don't see any R matrix. This is just a cotangent matrix. Before the symplectic structure in JK variable, you don't see R matrix. All is very nice. But to relate them, you need R matrix. Unusual. Normally, in many Poisson asymmetric systems, R matrices appear already in the definition of the symplectic factors. Here it does
not. Kostas, do you have a question?
I wanted to ask about cosets, but maybe you answered it already in the conclusions. So what happens if I generalize from principal chiral model to coset spaces?
It remains integral.
So everything you said
will... Everything goes through. What I said goes through. The model remains possibly symmetric, but it develops some residual gauge symmetry, which still it does not put in danger neither integrability nor continuality. So this is the work of Teldu. Actually, when I wrote the paper as the answer to the Cheretnik problem, I wrote it in 2008. Except maybe of Cheretnik, a few people integrated, nobody remarked. Then I had a student, and I was looking for somebody who would write a report on the thesis. So I contacted Teldu. So he has seen it, and then he wrote a paper about it. And now people know about this paper.
Maybe
it's related to
that question, but what is it guarantees that the beta function stays zero and you get
what
a proper string back?
That, can I tell you honestly? Yeah. Direct calculation. I don't have any theoretical. No.
Like, how do you know what R matrix I can choose?
What is amazing already that, you know, this system, which is this young Baxter model, whatever coordinate you use, I don't use coordinates here. But people who work on that in SU2 case, many physicists, they take this thing and they write everything in Euler angles. And then if you calculate the beta function, this comes as a miracle that it vanishes. And even here, look how it's happened that the radiative correction just move this alpha. You know that there are a lot of terms which can contribute. And it's just this alpha change, nothing else. So it means that this model keeps this possible symmetry even in the quantum case, and probably there is some quantum groups to it.
Okay, thanks to Radian.